Blackstone Audiobooks presents Gulliver's Travels by Jonathan Swift. A letter from Captain Gulliver to his cousin Simpson. I hope you will be ready to own publicly, whenever you shall be called to it, that by your great and frequent urgency, you prevailed on me to publish a very loose and uncorrect account of my travels, with direction to hire some young gentleman of either university to put them in order and correct the style, as my cousin Dampier did by my advice in his book called A Voyage Round the World. But I do not remember, I gave you power to consent, that anything should be omitted, and much less that anything should be inserted. Therefore, as to the latter, I do here renounce everything of that kind, particularly a paragraph about Her Majesty the late Queen Anne, of most pious and glorious memory. Although I did reverence and esteem her more than any of human species. But you or your interpolator ought to have considered that as it was not my inclination, so was it not decent to praise any animal of our composition before my master Houyhnhnms. And besides, the fact was altogether false, for to my knowledge, being in England during some part of Her Majesty's reign, she did govern by chief minister, nay, even by two successively. The first whereof was the Lord of Godolphin, and the second the Lord of Oxford. So that you have made me say the thing which was not. Likewise, in the account of the Academy of Projectors, and several passages of my discourse to my master Houyhnhnms, you must have either omitted some material circumstances, or minced or changed them in such a manner, that I do hardly know mine own work. When I formally hinted to you something of this in a letter, you were pleased to answer that you were afraid of giving offence, that people in power were very watchful over the press, and apt not only to interpret, but to punish everything which looked like an innuendo, as I think you called it. But pray, how could that which I spoke so many years ago, and at above 5,000 leagues distance, in another reign, be applied to any of the Yahoos, who now are said to govern the herd? Especially at a time when I little thought on or feared the unhappiness of living under them. Have not I the most reason to complain when I see those very Yahoos carried by Houyhnhnms in a vehicle, as if these were brutes and those the rational creatures? And indeed, to avoid so monstrous and detestable a sight was one principal motive of my retirement hither. Thus much I thought proper to tell you in relation to yourself and to the trust I reposed in you. I do in the next place complain of my own great want of judgment in being prevailed upon by the entreaties and false reasonings of you and some others, very much against mine own opinion, to suffer my travels to be published. Pray bring your mind how often I desired you to consider, when you insisted on the motive of public good, that the Yahoos were a species of animals utterly incapable of amendment by precepts or examples. And so it hath proved. For instead of seeing a full stop put to all abuses and corruptions, at least in this little island, as I had reason to expect, behold, after above 6 months' warning, I cannot learn that my book hath produced one single effect according to mine intentions. I desired you would let me know by a letter when party and faction were extinguished, judges learned and upright, pleaders honest and modest, with some tincture of common sense, and Smithfield blazing with pyramids of law books, the young nobility's education entirely changed, the physicians banished, the female Yahoos abounding in virtue, honour, truth, and good sense. Courts and levies of great ministers thoroughly weeded and swept. Wit, merit, and learning rewarded. All disgraces of the press in prose and verse condemned to eat nothing but their own cotton and quench their thirst with their own ink. These and a thousand other reformations I firmly counted upon by your encouragement, as indeed they were plainly deducible from the precepts delivered in my book. And it must be owned that 7 months were a sufficient time to correct every vice and folly to which Yahoos are subject. If their natures had been capable of the least disposition to virtue or wisdom, yet so far have you been from answering mine expectation in any of your letters, that on the contrary, you are loading our carrier every week with libels and keys and reflections and memoirs and second parts. Wherein I see myself accused of reflecting upon great statesfolk, of degrading human nature, for so they have still the confidence to style it, and of abusing the female sex. I find, likewise, that the writers of those bundles are not agreed among themselves, for some of them will not allow me to be author of mine own travels, and others make me author of books to which I am wholly a stranger. I find, likewise, that your printer hath been so careless as to confound the times and mistake the dates of my several voyages and returns, neither assigning the true year, or the true month or day of the month, and I hear the original manuscript is all destroyed since the publication of my book. Neither have I any copy left. However, I have sent you some corrections which you may insert, if ever there should be a second edition. And yet I cannot stand to them, but shall leave that matter to my judicious and candid readers, to adjust it as they please. I hear some of our sea yahoos find fault with my sea language, as not proper in many parts, nor now in use. I cannot help it. In my first voyages, while I was young, I was instructed by the oldest mariners, and learned to speak as they did. But I have since found that the sea yahoos are apt, like the land ones, to become new-fangled in their words, which the latter change every year. Insomuch, as I remember upon each return to mine own country, their old dialect was so altered that I could hardly understand the new. And I observe when any yahoo comes from London out of curiosity to visit me at mine own house, we neither of us are able to deliver our conceptions in a manner intelligible to the other. If the censure of yahoos could any way affect me, I should have great reason to complain that some of them are so bold as to think my book of travels a mere fiction out of mine own brain, and have gone so far as to drop hints that the Houyhnhnms and yahoos have no more existence than the inhabitants of Utopia. Indeed, I must confess that as to the people of Lilliput...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.